So, welcome. We are thrilled to see all of you here tonight for Peter Ames Carlin reading his new book, Homeward Bound, The Life of Paul Simon. My name is Mel, and I'm an events coordinator here at University Bookstore. We are one of the oldest independent bookstores in Washington State. We host over 400 events a year. Sometimes we have multiple in a night. Tonight we have three events going on at different places, so it's kind of crazy, but fun. You can find a list of our upcoming events on our website, and we also have a flyer on the top over there that's for November. So if you're interested in wanting to know what else is coming, feel free to check that out. Let me tell you a little bit about Peter if you don't already know. He is a writer and the author of several books, including Bruce, a biography of Bruce Springsteen, which is also on the cube over there with his new book. A regular speaker of or on music, art, and popular culture, Peter lives not too far from us in Portland, Oregon with his wife and children. A few last notes before we get started. If you parked in our lot behind us and you have one of those little white cards, see me afterwards and I'll get you stamped so that you don't have to pay for your parking tonight. And just so you know, we don't close until 8, but at 7:50, you'll probably hear this announcement and it'll seem kind of weird. They'll be like, hey, we're closing in 10 minutes. So don't worry about that. You're welcome to stay as long as you want and chat with Peter afterwards and get him to sign your book. Books are available for purchase, as I said, on the cube, and I'll be happy to ring you up if the registers have closed over at Kids, so just let me know. Now, please join me in welcoming Peter Ames Carlin.
Hello, thank you for coming. I feel like I know most of you already, which is great. I feel like I don't know how to, there we go. So it's really great to be back in Seattle, where I, as I think a lot of you know, where I actually grew up. As a result, the genesis of this book really goes back to Seattle, not a couple miles from here, up on Capitol Hill, where I grew up with my parents, who just happened to be here tonight. The summer of 1968, I think we'd been in our house on Crescent Drive on Capitol Hill for about a little more than a year, and it was a hot summer, I remember that much, and I used to sit out in the backyard during the afternoons and sort of push my trucks around, because, as I say, that was my job back then, and all summer long, there were kids out in the McGlynn's yard and next door. What was that family with the girls?
The Merricks.
The Merricks. Yeah. And the workers over the backyard that were doing the work building retaining wall or something. And they all listened to the same radio station, which was KJR 95. And at the time, KJR was the reigning top 40 station in this city. And they played a really tight playlist like you did back in the day. And so I listened to Mrs. Robinson about every 18 minutes between Memorial Day weekend and Labor Day weekend. And so as a little kid with my little trucks, I'm spending, you know, it's like it's coming on the wind, like every, you know, like a lot, you know, that dee, 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 dee. And you listen to that enough, and eventually you begin to absorb it a little bit. You got to think about, like, well, what's happening here with these guys? Like Joe DiMaggio, I had no clue, right? But I mean, I sort of was aware of this character, but I was mostly aware of those voices and that song and that kind of that sort of off-kilter rhythm, and it just sort of snuck its way into my head, and it's honestly never left, which is interesting to me, because as I grew up in Seattle, over the next few years, I went to Stevens Elementary School just up the street from us, and then to Madrona and Middle, you know, I mean, and throughout my entire career as a grade school student, as a junior high student, as a sort of as a sulky adolescent, and all the way through, there was always Paul Simon music that was a part of my experience growing up. And always, I never forgot those moments in the backyard. With my trucks and Mrs. Robinson. The other sort of salient question that has come to matter more to me over the years, which again connects to that moment, is what was I doing in a backyard in Seattle listening to Simon and Garfunkel without meaning to? how is it that people like me, and my family is in a way very much like the Paul Simon's family, is that we're immigrant Jews. Our relatives came to this country in the late 19th and early 20th centuries, escaping the rise of anti-Semitism and communism in back there. It was a dark days, and so our people came on ships, and they came over to the United States and to generally Ellis Island, and then into New York, and in both of our families' cases to New Jersey. Paul's family went to Newark, and our family went to Atlantic City, anticipating the Trumps by 50, 60 years, and never once going bankrupt. So. But it became the classic immigrant tale, the story of people who come from the old world and come to America to sort of remake themselves and to build for themselves a future of their own devising. In Paul Simon's family, this began almost immediately. His grandfather, who was also named Paul Simon, was trained as a tailor back in the Austro-Hungarian Empire, and set up a shop in Newark. And if you're familiar with the novels of Philip Roth, that's Philip Roth's Newark. And it's the sort of strange world of these motor-mouthed Yiddish speakers in the corner, and the pickle barrels, and the industrialists, and this kind of endless, this sort of collision between the old world ways, the orthodox, and the assimilationists, and this kind of not very long, as it turned out, arc from orthodoxy to full-on assimilation. Paul's father, Louis Simon, was the first American-born generation, and in that family. And from the moment he hit the ground, it seems, he had zero interest in the traditions of his family or religion or anything that had anything to do with the past. And he very quickly became involved in music, in jazz music particularly. And it turned out that he had quite a talent for playing the bass. And by the time he was in high school, he was playing shows professionally. And when he joined the union, at first in New Jersey, and then in 1935, when he moved to New York to attend NYU, he joined the New York Musicians Union. And the idea at first was to have a kind of cool way to make money, to put yourself through college, as opposed to flipping burgers somewhere or digging ditches or doing those other jobs. He fairly quickly learned to take a name that had no ethnic connection whatsoever, which was Lee Sims. And so for decades, for the entire time he was a professional musician, he worked as Lee Sims. And in fact, for many years, had a fairly popular jazz band called, or dance band, society band, called the Lee Sims Orchestra. His son, Paul Simon, of course, also had that same talent for music. And from the time that he started playing, he met his friend Artie Garfunkel when they were both in grade school. Artie also came from a very similar sort of immigration, you know, immigrant family past. And they shared this love for popular music, for doo-wop, and for rhythm and blues, and for early rock and roll. And they began to sing together after school every day. And when they finally had sort of discovered enough, learned their own how to sing and how to interpret other people's music, but also how to write music, they by the time they were in seniors in high school, they scored a record contract to record a song of their own writing, which was called "Hey Schoolgirl in the Second Row." But of course, you can't have a couple pop singers in the mid-50s, you know, just as Louis Simon was not going to get society gigs, and as Louis Simon, he had to be Lee Sims. It was very obvious to the owner of the record company that signed them to do this, to make this record, that they had to have another name. And so they chose Tom and Jerry, which were, God damn it, Jack, turn off your phone. What the hell? Sorry. Yeah, the one. Chose the wrong time for that to happen, brother. It's great when you can, after known this guy for longer than I've been alive, and Mr. Carr for so many years, and now I can just yell at him in public. It's like, that's like the benefit to aging, I guess. there's got to be one, right? So they took that name, and it was that fluidity of identity. They both did this cheerfully. Lewis Simon and Lee Sims. Lou had no problem with that. He had absolutely no problem with that. He didn't give a shit about the synagogue. He didn't care about the past. He was a new man in a new country. It's like the thing I came back to over and over again, which I think is the quote that starts the book. There's a name for it. I always want to say anagram, but that's not it. Somebody smarter than me knows this. But it's from the opening lines of The Adventures of Augie Marsh. Augie Marsh, excuse me, that says, I'm an American, Chicago born. And from there, you realize this is a story of a very prototypical Jewish immigrant, only the fact of his being Jewish has absolutely no bearing on anything that happens in the course of the book. And there lies the roots of Philip Roth and a bunch of other modernist Jewish writers. But for Paul, as eager as he was to abandon his identity, you know, or his cultural identity, or not his identity per se, but his past, and to an extent his identity as a middle class kid of fair, you know, aspiring Jewish people, he was also starved for other cultural experiences. And so he began, even as a grade schooler, to just jump on his bike after school and go from neighborhood to neighborhood in Queens and find his way to the Puerto Rican neighborhoods and to the Irish neighborhoods and the Italian neighborhoods and just bike around the block and listen to what was, you know, the music coming out of the shops, listen to the language and people speaking to one another, and smell the smells coming out of the bakeries and the restaurants, and just sort of absorb a certain element of it. One of the more interesting things I learned, there's a, especially for those of us who know what would come in Paul Simon's career, particularly with the music he would make in South Africa many years later, is that there's a white South African musician named Johnny Clegg, who played in a biracial band called Jaluka. And Johnny Clegg is not only, I mean, he's a great source for a guy like me because he's not only a musician, he's not only from South Africa, he's not only an anti-apartheid activist and has been forever, who has always consciously formed biracial bands. He is also an immigrant Jew whose family, instead of going to America, went from Poland to Africa. And Johnny told me, he said, traditionally, secular Jews have always been starved for other cultures because they've abandoned or they've left their own culture behind. And as a result, they've always looked into other cultures and taken as much as they can, found a connection, and didn't necessarily take it for their own, but at least always had this sort of overwhelming appetite. And when we think about Paul Simon and his career over the last 60 years, what we see is an artist who has almost, if there's one thing that threads through his entire career, a career which began with him as a sort of wannabe, sort of teen idol character with Artie Garfunkel as Tom and Jerry, singing Hey Schoolgirl in the second row. Before that, they had been doo-wop singers. They'd had a doo-wop band. Once they sort of broke up for a variety of reasons, Paul became a brill-building songwriter and wrote pop songs, you know, even when he was in college, under a whole other identity named Jerry Landis, that he found his way from pop music into eventually folk music, and then from folk music into folk rock, into sort of straight rock and roll, into neo-psychedelic rock and roll, into Chilean folk music, into reggae, into southern rhythm and blues and gospel music, deeply into gospel music, African-American gospel music, drawn deeply into the African-American culture, and then onward up into everything that would happen after that, sort of art pop music in the mid 70s, Latin music in the late 70s, and then all the way to South Africa for the Graceland album that was both so extraordinarily successful and beautiful, but also very controversial, and onward and onward back into the African, the music of the African diaspora coming from West Africa into South America and then all the way up in through Brazil and finally up into Cuba and Puerto Rico and eventually up into the Bronx. And it's this amazing journey of discovery, which is, as far as I've been able to see, and this was the idea I had when I originally started the book, is that it is essentially the assimilation process sort of rewritten over and over and over and over again in musical terms. And at many times it's been enormously controversial. And I think this, again, I know there were some people who came here tonight hoping to not talk about politics. Or this political race. So sorry. But again, I mean, this is at least a gentle echo of it. I mean, we talk about this idea that there should be, for all the talk of building walls these days and keeping people out, that's something that has been enacted not only literally over the past, but in our cultural history over and over again. And Paul Simon, who is without a doubt a very prickly and uncomfortable character at times, has always followed this impulse of unification in his own, you know, which of course has to be performed under his own terms, because again, he's a somewhat prickly character. But you go down to Greenwich Village, again, we get back to the idea of identity and the change of identity, the willful change of identity, and the willful change of the past, where Paul and Artie, when they first started singing as a folk duo in the early 60s, went down, like you would do in those days, down to Greenwich Village to sing in the clubs there and get some attention. And the strict constructionist American folkies there, who were all sort of descendant of Woody Guthrie and Pete Seeger and the sort of dusty kind of blues singers and this idea. But they're all middle-class white people, but nevertheless, they feel like they found some great authenticity. And the appearance of Paul and Artie from middle-class Queens is completely unacceptable. Whereas, and so they were stymied. They were basically sent away in tears. Whereas the appearance of Bob Dylan, who of course, as we all know, was born on an Indian reservation in New Mexico, and grew up in Carney shows, riding the rails through his childhood on his way eventually to New York, or to put it more succinctly, was the son of well-to-do Jewish merchants in Hibbing, Minnesota, which is what he was. But they bought the other story because he told it so well. And the fact that even though it only took about a year for the media to catch up with him, and I think Newsweek and then the Little Sandy Review to say, this Bob Dylan fellow is actually Robert Zimmerman from Hibbing, Minnesota. And if you actually, just parenthetically, if you were in Hibbing, or maybe it's still up right now, the other week when the announcement came that Dylan won the Nobel Prize for Literature, the little reader board that they got outside the school where it says like "Go Rangers" or whatever, and "Homecoming this weekend" or "Have a good Thanksgiving," said "Congratulations, Robert Zimmerman, class of '59." Nobel winner for literature. And that's, yeah, and well deserved too. And I think there's, from what I've come to understand, there's a lot of, I was last week I was in Nashville doing a thing at Vanderbilt University with some other writers, and one guy is a particular Dylan expert, and he said that Bob is quite close to these people that only knew him back in Hibbing. He's got a very solid core of kids who still probably refer to him as Bobby Zimmerman. So, you know, as you run and then you can't always hide. But you can definitely build yourself a pretty kick-ass alter ego, and if you do it well enough, and walk it like you talk it, then that's who, in America, then that's who you are. That was a lot of what drew me into Paul Simon when I thought about whether I should write a book about this guy. I mean, clearly the music speaks for itself. It's an amazing career. It's almost three different, he's already in the Hall of Fame, the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame twice. First for Simon and Garfunkel, second for his solo work. But I think that you could put him in the Hall of Fame twice for his solo work. First for the first 15 years of incredible music from There Goes Rhyme and Simon and Still Crazy After All These Years and the One Trick Pony record and Hearts and Bones with an amazing dozens of hits off of those. And then if you could start all over again in 1986 with Graceland and the world beat music and everything he's done since then, which has reflected this astonishing inner, you know, appreciation and depth of knowledge for international music, for, you know, for music from all over the world. That is, to my mind, a third Hall of Fame winning, you know, career right there. And yet, and part of the reason why I'm coming at this the way that I am today, instead of telling you all the juicy stuff about his big fights with Artie Garfunkel over the years, which we can definitely get into if you guys want to. I mean, we can do that during the Q&A part. and I'm happy to do it. Don't get me wrong. It's great. It's like, it's operatic. You know, and his celebrity marriages to, you know, Carrie Fisher and now to Edie Brickell and the part where they got busted for disturbing the peace. Jack, is that you again? That's okay.
It's the Trump Foundation.
Yes, it is. They're wondering where your next donation's gonna land. People have always built these walls in England, and that's one of the amazing things. It ties this horrible election we're in the middle of right now to this experience of this musician who really, despite the fact that he is an alarmingly prickly and at times very tone, you know, sort of ethically tone deaf person who is spiteful and mean to a degree, and also wonderfully generous and sweet. But the fact that every time he has tried to make one of these leaps into one of the other cultures, there has generally been a huge amount of resistance, and part of it is, you know, like I said, in Greenwich Village, they were not interested in middle-class folkies. In England, they hated Americans, and especially Americans who wrote songs. And in fact, the British folk scene was so stratified that this fellow, Ewan McCall, who ran a club in England, a folk club, with his wife Peggy Seeger, who was an American, and I think one other fellow, were so sort of dominant in the British folk scene that if you wanted to play their club, you had to basically perform for them privately. And if you were going to say that you were going to perform folk ballads from the 18th century from this region of the Lake District, if you showed up and you weren't playing the right kind of lute and singing with the right accent, well, then you just had to fuck off, because this is not authentic and we're not interested. And that basically controlled, you know, the real, you know, the traditional folk clubs around England. In the same way, when Paul Simon tried to, you know, did his Graceland record, which he could have recorded in a much more politically savvy way, except for his stubbornness. I mean, again, he was greeted, or once the record was finished and it came out, there was, I think, as probably many of us remember, this great uproar, you know, on two levels. One of cultural imperialism, like, who are you to perform this music? And then, of course, the other, the somewhat still unresolved question of whether he violated the cultural boycott in place as a result of the apartheid racist government. That's more complicated. The cultural imperialism thing, I think, is a much more easier to follow thing. Should a white kid from New York be able to go to Africa and come back with music he recorded with those people and call it his own music? Or is that theft of some deep and terrible way? But I'm going to leave you with this on this account, and then I'm happy to answer every question that you all might have. Is that a lot of that music that he fell in love with at first, the Township Jive and the Umbakanga music and a few other varieties, part of the reason why it hit him so hard in a time when he was feeling, I think, at some sort of crisis personally and artistically, was because it sounded so familiar to him. It sounded like doo-wop music. It sounded like all this beautiful R&B that he had grown up with, only sort of coming through this whole other filter. Where the rhythms were almost exactly like rockabilly, but different, and the scales were different, and the instruments were in many ways different, or certainly the instrumentation. And yet it sounded like the most familiar thing. It sounded like the voice of his father calling him, I think would be one way to put it. It turned out that a lot of that music was, all that South African pop music was flowed down through the same influences that the music Paul came to know and love in the early 50s did. Because one of the unintended benefits of centuries of dread imperialism is that South Africa, while it was systematically being raped for its people and for its resources, they were also a lively port in which Western products and Western music and Western instruments and traditions were coming into their country. And so they took, in the 20s, a musician named Solomon Linda was a Zulu tribes member, but also a very popular singer, was so inspired by the ragtime records and early jazz records and early blues records that he was hearing from America, that he took those rhythms and combined them with his Zulu chants, and came up with a song called Imbubi, which we know better as Wimowe or The Lion Sleeps Tonight. And so, in other words, the reason Imbubi was such a huge hit in South Africa was because it was African music filtered through African American music. It was their own sounds being reflected back to them through this whole other filter. And so Solomon Linda reflected it back. And Imbubi came to, through Alan Lomax, got to Pete Seeger, who was then in the Weavers in the 40s. And they didn't understand Imbubi, so they said, well, it sounds like Wimowe to me. So, and so the Weavers recorded this chant, and it was a number one hit for them in 1949. And remained popular over the first half of the 50s. And then some smart aleck decided to write English lyrics for it, which involved the lions, The Lion Sleeps Tonight, which a group called the Tokens recorded in 1959, 1960, which was such a huge hit in 1961 that it inspired Paul, who was then working as Jerry Landis and was producing a band called Tico and the Triumphs, who needed a B-side. He wrote a song called Wildflower, which has all that, which essentially channels The Lion Sleeps Tonight into this kind of not very good, but interesting sounding pop song, which was the B-side to this tune called Locomotive or something, which is a cool song. It didn't do very well at all. So in other words, when you talk about Paul Simon, and this idea of music sort of intermingling and this kind of heartbeat connection that connects people from all around the world, which I think is a large part of what resonates with us for all of Paul Simon's music through the Simon and Garfunkel years and his rhythm and blues years and all the way up through this. All of that goes back not only to Solomon Linda, and not only through the Weavers and Wimowe and the Tokens, but to the fact that he recorded his first South African-inspired song in 1961 as a B-side for a pop song that nobody cared about. But it's that feeling and that rhythm and that that connects not only us to everyone else in the world, but Paul Simon's music to everyone in the world. And now I'll take questions. Thank you.
Chuck. Is it true that he refused to cooperate with you on the writing of the book and also told his friends not to cooperate with you?
That's all very true, and in fact it's so true that he not only asked them to not cooperate with me, he also asked them to not even acknowledge having heard from me, which got awkward at times for some people because they would have already acknowledged and said, well, this sounds cool, I'd like to do this, but I should talk to Paul. And I would say, of course you should talk to Paul. And then some of them never got back to me after that, and I began to wonder, like, well, what's that about? Is this some Russian hack of my computer? Mm-hmm. But then someone else, I would get calls every so often from somebody who would say, well, you know, actually, I was asked not to call you back, but that's not who I am, so I just want to let you know I can't do it. And so it was very easy to put together two and two. That said, it didn't really change my opinion of Paul or his music. I mean, it was frustrating, but it didn't necessarily sour me on the guy. I think there's a lot of artists, you can't listen to Paul Simon's music and think that he's not a complicated guy with like dark sides. It's like if he were different, then I'd have to rethink everything. And I'm too lazy for that. So it actually was reassuring that this was the way that it was. Yes, ma'am.
Why, from what you learned about him, why do you think he is so prickly? Because he's had that reputation for a long time.
For a variety of reasons. I mean, he's never been satisfied, and he's talked about this repeatedly, he's never been satisfied with the way that he looks. He's a little bit short, which you may or may not, I think everybody knows that. He didn't like the way that he never thought he was all that handsome. He didn't really like the way that his voice sounded. He especially didn't like it after he heard Artie Garfunkel sing, which was one reason why he had this sort of the depth of his friendship for Artie, and especially when it came to their partnership, was that he knew that Artie had such a beautiful voice that he could make his music sound way better. And he actually had and there was quite a bit of sort of frustration between the two of them, and there was a lot of, I mean, they got on beautifully during most of the Simon and Garfunkel era, but then you get around to the Bridge Over Troubled Water moment, where Artie started that career in movies at Paul's insistence, and you can hear that if you know the Bridge Over Troubled Water record, the song "Only Living Boy in New York." It's essentially a combination of a love letter and a farewell to Artie, saying, you know, he refers to him in that song as Tom, which was his pseudonym with Tom and Jerry, and he says, you know, get your flight down to Mexico, and you know, I know you've been waiting to fly, and it's like this loving farewell. But once Artie had that and had this mode of expression that didn't depend on Paul, then that, you know, the resentment flourished immediately, and that became a long, drawn-out thing. But the moment that he knew he was going to go solo, then it was endless panic attacks, and very soon, 5-day-a-week psychotherapy for Paul to figure out, like, how do I go on? What am I now? Like, does anybody, like, I know I can write songs, but does anybody want to hear me sing them? Does anybody want to ever see me, go come out and see me perform without this handsome, tall, golden-haired, golden-voiced buddy standing next to me? So, yeah, he's prickly. He's got issues. Yes.
How much of a career did Art Garfunkel have after they split up?
He had a pretty big career, actually. Yeah, no, if you go back and you look at the pop charts in the 70s, I mean, he put out two or three, four records, and most of them had pretty significant hits on them. Mm. And the movie career was something for at least the first few years. I mean, Carnal Knowledge, he was in Catch 22 first. That wasn't that huge a hit, but it was part of, you know, he was just one part of an enormous ensemble. And then there was Carnal Knowledge, which I believe did well. Mm-hmm. Did that do well? I mean, Jack Nicholson, Anne Margaret, everybody.
Yeah.
And then there were other films and, and then a lot of these hits. And they both sort of hit a tough, hit sort of a rougher patch in the late 70s, early 80s. I think after Artie put out a record and a movie that were both panned and did badly, right at the same time that Paul put out his One Trick Pony record, which was, only kind of moderately successful. Like, it didn't quite hit the top 10, and he only had one top 5 single on it. So for him, it was devastation. It's all relative, I guess. And then they, very soon after that, reunited for the big Central Park show, and then the 2-year, sellout world tour of stadiums. And so they've always sort of, there have been more than one, there are multiple times when they've returned to one another as a way to kind of reboot their careers, I guess.
Yes. Do you choose your subject or just your editor choose your subject?
I choose my subjects.
And then why?
Why?
That genre, yeah.
Why this particular genre?
Yeah.
I'm fascinated by it.
It's the music of your life, basically.
Well, there's that, yeah. I mean, my whole...
Or ours.
Well, it goes back to trucks.
Goes, excuse me?
It goes back to trucks.
Well, it goes back to the trucks. Precisely. Thank you, David. It was just a question of following my passion. I mean, the first music book I wrote was about Brian Wilson from the Beach Boys, who had been like one of my idols since I was 13. And I got a chance to meet him and interview him in the 90s when I worked at People magazine. But I mean, and that was sort of like a sort of a dream come true. And that just sort of built up into more and more stuff. And finally, I was like, I got to write a book about this guy. And it took a long time. And once I got that going, they gave me a chance to write another book. And basically, the idea was, well, you did pretty well with the music guy. You might as well stick with music. So then Paul McCartney came next, and then the Springsteen thing, and then after the Springsteen thing did well, my agent was telling me, my name came up somewhere, and someone goes, well, he's just a music writer. And I was like, what? Because music is literally, like, in the 30 plus years I've been writing for money, is like less than 10% of what I've written about. Except for now, I mean, it's good to be known for doing anything in my business. And so, obviously I'll take it, but at some point if I can come up with another idea. But yes. So I get to choose what I do.
What's next?
That's sort of a sore point. Can we, any other questions? I've got some ideas that are kicking around. I'm trying to figure stuff out, but this is like an awkward, I'm not one of those guys that's like already halfway through the next thing when he's like, oh, I've got to recover for a little while, and then there's a certain amount of just avoidance techniques and a lot of laziness and a lot of looking at every electron pole. That's time consuming. Yes?
So along the same lines of her question, so why now for this book about Paul?
Okay.
Was it just something you've been waiting to do for a long time, or was there some other sort of seminal event that kind of triggered it for you?
Well, it was one of these things of some other wiseacre said, what are you going to do next? and I thought, like, oh, that's a good question. What do I want to? And then it was like, at that point, there was so much momentum to do another music book because the Springsteen book had done real well, and it just was like, this is kind of the time. If you're ever going to write another music book, this would be the time to do that, which my agent made fairly clear to me in a series of pointed emails. And it was like, so there's a few things. Like, who do I feel passionately about? Like, whose music matters to me? And then you do a Google search or look around and see what other books, what's the literature so far? And for Paul Simon, as with Springsteen, it was astonishing. I mean, there have been no, this is like the first researched book about Paul Simon. I mean, there's a few small ones out there. I mean, there's a couple that came out of England that are pretty good. They're real good on his years in London. But then a lot of it is just kind of cut and paste because people, I mean, I had the luxury to be able to invest time and say, you know, and invest money in traveling. And so I spent a ton of time in New York. I went back and forth to LA a couple times. I went to Cleveland for, you know, the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame archives has a ton of fascinating stuff. I went to London, up to Liverpool, went to Atlanta to see him speak at Emory University. I had a really weird sort of moment from afar with him there, which is at the very end of the book. And it was just a question of, like, there's nothing there. It's like, and you'd think Paul Simon readers are like, or Paul Simon listeners are like the, you know, the most literary of all rock and roll musicians or listeners. So it's like, duh. And then, fortunately, the publishing world agreed. So here we are. Chris?
Peter, do you think that there was no book because he wouldn't cooperate, and he wouldn't cooperate because he didn't really want there to be a book?
I think that was part of it. I think the other part of it is that, unlike Springsteen or Paul McCartney or Brian Wilson, his reputation is so kind of, people love his music, but I think they're pretty, at best, kind of a little ambivalent about him as a guy. There's a lot of interesting stuff going on. That relationship with Artie Garfunkel, I think, is just endlessly fascinating and like a soap opera, only bitchier. And the business with being married to Carrie Fisher and that whole thing, it's like there's a lot of stuff there, but there's a lot about Paul that's just sort of like, ew. You know, I mean, it's like you feel like the less you know, the better. But on the other hand, I mean, the other thing that people don't talk about very much is how integrally involved he was in so much of the last 60 years of not only a musical history, but cultural history. You start with him, you know, the civil rights songs that he wrote that made him a very, you know, a voice in the civil rights movement. His work, his years in the Brill Building and in that sort of late 50s kind of Tin Pan Alley scene. His work as a board member and a founder of the Monterey Pop Festival. And also just how involved he was to a degree in the start of Saturday Night Live. Mm-hmm. And his role, a fairly significant role in Woody Allen's Annie Hall, which of course I think is maybe still the most beloved Woody Allen movie ever. And onward up through the anti-apartheid struggle, the thing on Broadway with the Cape Man, and regardless, the Cape Man is a beautiful, contains beautiful music. I mean, I was listening to some of it today when I was driving up here, and it took me years to really get it, but once I did, I was deep, you know. But he was at that point where, and he didn't succeed, but he was part of that movement to modernize Broadway from the old school, you know, all singing, all dancing thing to kind of more of a modern rock and roll era type of you know, the Hamilton world that we know now. You could argue whether that's a good thing or a bad thing. I mean, I think everybody loves Hamilton, but he was definitely a part of that. So all that gets me. Yes, Mae.
So he announced his retirement.
Yeah, I'll tell you what, though. He announced his retirement in 1958 because he and Artie were going to be going to college in the fall, and so therefore they were going to be leaving rock and roll behind to be serious people. He announced his retirement.
Good evening, shoppers. The time is now 7:50, and the university bookstore will be closing in 10 minutes.
He announced his retirement in 1966 after the first two or three Simon and Garfunkel hits, because he was really a novelist and he was going to write the great American novel. He announced his retirement in 1975 just because he was finished with music. He announced his retirement in 1997 when he was going to do the Cape Man and his career performance days were over. And then that fellow Jim Dwyer at the New York Times, apparently not having read the clips, heard him say that too, and went, not only did he come in for the big sort of like couple ammo story, then it was like such a huge deal that 5 days later, this is a rarity in daily journalism, which I was a part of for many years, it came back with the how I got that story. And meanwhile, I'm sitting there like, son of a bitch! It's like, wait till my, and I went back and checked the manuscript to make sure I put in all that other stuff, so I wouldn't have to go back and put it in then, like as a real spiteful, angry person. But fortunately, it was already there, so that's just straight up not spiteful, but just real. You had a question.
Yeah, what is he doing now? That's what I was gonna, she was talking about his excitement to retirement. I mean, is he writing music in the past few years? What is he doing, and how does he compare, would you say, in the whole folk ballad sort of world, is that 60s compared to other people in the folk ballad sort of world?
Yeah, he's on tour. He just, I think today or yesterday, started a European tour. Generally, that's his thing. Whether he comes back and plays more shows in the States, I don't know. He definitely, I think he may also, if he hasn't already, he's going to go down to Australia. So he's always performing, or will continue to perform for a while. And if past is prologue, then he's probably also scribbling, working on songs. He's a huge kvetch when it comes to talking about songwriting. It's like whenever he talks about it, it's like, ugh. It's so painful for me. It's so horrible. I don't know why I do it. And it's like, well, then stop. But then he doesn't. So because it's not only like who he is, it's like what he is. So I think for a lot of those guys, you see these guys like that Desert Trip Festival a couple weeks ago. It was Dylan and the Stones and Paul McCartney and that guy from Pink Floyd and Neil Young. And it's like, why are these dudes still up there? And they're all in their 70s now. And, and it's like, what are they supposed to be doing? I mean, were they supposed to quit at some, like, at 30 or 40 or 50 and just, like, work on their coin collections? It's like, you do this one thing, and not only is it sort of like your interaction with the world, it's the thing that, it's like, to a great extent, is what keeps you alive. I think if you retire from that, then that's like just saying, I'm going to die soon. And I don't think anybody wants to admit that. And then there was a second, how does he compare?
How does he compare to, like, other folk rock people of that era?
Okay.
I mean, how did the critics, look at all these folk
rock? Oh, when they look back at,
Yeah.
He was always very competitive with and resentful of Bob Dylan, because they're very similar guys. They're almost exactly the same age. Dylan got all the attention and he didn't. And so if you listen to, there's actually two versions of it, but if you have that Simon and Garfunkel record, Parsley, Sage, Rosemary, and Thyme, that has that song, A Simple Desultory Philippic, which is essentially a very long and cruel satire of Bob Dylan, then you get a little sense into how he felt about Dylan. Al Stewart, the folk singer-songwriter guy, Year of the Cat, anybody? He shared a flat with Paul and some other people in the mid-60s, and when Desolation Row came out, he was listening to it nonstop, and he played it for Paul, and Paul said, well, this is just warmed over Ferlinghetti. And Al Stewart said, if you could ever write a song that was half this brilliant, it would be astonishing. And Paul didn't talk to him for a month. And so when Dylan won the Nobel Prize, I was tickled to see that the announcement came on Paul's 75th birthday. The fates can be cruel. But hopefully at this time, I think he's well over that sort of thing. But I think, the fascinating thing about Paul is the endless growth. I mean, I think of a lot of those guys, you think of somebody like, who are the other, like, great folk singer-songwriters in those days? I mean, Dylan constantly changes, too. I mean, that's what those two guys have in common, is that, I mean, for Dylan, it's always, it is more literary to a degree. The different voices he's taken on, the different vision of America, that's his particular thing. And Paul, it's just all music. It's just, I mean, he writes beautiful lyrics, but for him, it's that constant change in sound and style and tone.
Yeah.
Yes.
When you get the idea, or jointly get the idea to do one of these, how do you approach the subject? I understand that you got along really swimmingly with Bruce. Is that, did you ask him permission and he said, fine, do whatever you like? And did you ask Paul permission and he would speak to you?
Well, when I started with Bruce, I was as much of an outlaw as I was. I mean, I didn't have a relationship with those guys. I mean, I knew people who knew those people, and I talked to them, and so we had friends in common. And the advice I got then was perfect. It was just, the guy just said, look, this fellow that I know is the husband of one of Bruce's managers, a writer named Dave Marsh, who's also written, who has written beautiful stuff about Bruce over the years, but hadn't in many years. But when I got the offer to do that book, I called him up and I said, I got this offer, I'd like to do it, but if you're saving string on a book that you're going to do, because he's so close to that whole scene and has been forever, then there's no point in me getting started. And he said, no, I'm not going to do that other book. I'm not going to write about Bruce again, but you should do it. And he goes, now you're going to ask me whether I can help you get access. And all I can tell you is you're just going to have to submit a request like everyone else, and they're going to say no. But what that no really means is maybe. So what you should do is get to work on the book that you want to write. Work on it. At the end of the process, they'll either talk to you or they won't, and you'll still have the book you wanted to write. So I thought, okay. And then a year and a half into that project, the phone rang one day, and it was Bruce's manager saying, do you have time to talk? And I was like, well, let's say I can make time. And fortunately, I was already planning to go to New York, and we met a few days later, and it was like, okay, we're ready to work with you. And then, so the second half of that project was very different from the first half. With Paul Simon, I thought I actually had a much better, I actually thought I came in with a pretty good hand, because I had gotten to know a ton of people who were very close, not only with Paul, with Bruce, but also with Paul, including Bruce's manager John, with whom I'd become fairly good friends in the process, and we're still friends. And he was the one who said, actually, I'd already had been having these thoughts to myself. He said, well, who are you going to do next? And I said, well, I got a list. He goes, well, you know who you really should do. And I said, he goes, Paul Simon. And I go, that's the name on the top of my list. He goes, well, it's decided. That's it. That's what you're doing. So I thought, he's been giving pretty good advice to Springsteen over the years, so I think I'll follow his advice here, too. But he still, you know, Paul asked him about me, but he still wasn't about to bend. Paul is very interested in being in complete control of things. And so, there you go.
How many books have been written about Springsteen, and since your book about him was so successful, why has he recently come out with this biography?
He had started writing that before I got started on my thing. So he'd been working on that for a few years, and then he sort of laid it aside. And I think that I think part of the reason why he was interested in working with me and giving me all that access was because he knew that his mother and his aunts were all alive at the time, and they were all in their 90s, or his mom was the youngest, so she was 88 or something, and the aunts were in their 90s, and remarkably hale and hearty people, but obviously that wasn't going to continue for very long. And so he sent me out to, or allowed me to speak to them at great length and detail. And so ultimately, I think I essentially created an oral history for him and his family. So when it was over, and I was cognizant of that, so when my thing was finished and it was out, I sent him all the transcripts and all the original recordings for his own files. I don't know whether he used them for his book. But he's been very sweet since when his book came out. It seems like to me he's been very conscious of mentioning my book in interviews and stuff and being really cool about it. Anyone else have a question? Yeah.
So I want to go back to the comment that you made about Western music imperialism. And
as I want to do. Go ahead.
So just
real quick, what's your impression of how Ladysmith Black Mambazo, was it, did they feel empowered? Did they feel taken advantage of? How did that all go down? I mean,
Ladysmith Black Mambazo and basically all the musicians that worked on Graceland love Paul to the nth, or to the nth degree, because he created careers for them that went so far beyond. He opened up the world to them after they had been relegated to the townships and had no indication that that was ever going to change. And he kicked that door open for them. And you could argue, you know, I mean, a lot of people were angry at Paul for not having any kind of explicit political message or explicit political songs on that record. But on the other hand, I think the fact that he managed, the fact that he took that music and that sound and projected it around the world, and in so doing, I think, projected the beauty and the humanity of these people, who were no longer, you could no longer ignore them. You know, it was easy to see as an abstraction, you know, you start seeing something about people getting clubbed and gassed and shot to death across the country, and you change the channel because it's a bummer and you feel like you have no real, you have no connection to it. You have no, there's nothing you can do. But in this case, this music came out of the radio or out of your speakers or whatever, and it was the most upbeat, loving, beautiful music you'd heard in a while. And then suddenly you have a dog in that fight, because how can these people be treated like this, and why? I'm gonna just, for kicks, I think just to end this, I'm gonna read, I swore to myself I wasn't gonna read this ever, but because it's so self-referential, it's entirely self-referential. But I think I'm gonna do it tonight because I'm at home, and even if it seems like a huge, this takes place, even if it seems like a huge sort of exercise in egocentrism, I think it's interesting. And then you'll forgive me because you've known me for so long. You'll take it in the context of all the other stuff.
We expect it.
There's that too. This takes place, and this was the thing, this sort of follows on those questions of Paul and his relationship to me, and this basically gets to the heart of it. And it takes place at that thing at Emory University in Atlanta a few years ago. I showed up, he was given a series of lectures as a part of their, they have a series that they call the Richard Ellman Lectures. And it involves like your topest drawer literary figures, your sort of Seamus Heaneys and Umberto Ecos and Solomon Rushdies, and this year Paul Simon, which they all used to their mutual aggrandizement to an almost wild degree. I missed the first lecture because I was in Brazil doing some other stuff, and sort of secret agent stuff. No, I was promoting the Springsteen book there. And I got up to Atlanta a day late and got there just in time for the second presentation, which was a public conversation with the poet Billy Collins, who I learned not to like in the course of that conversation, but that's another story. So I'll read this. I got to Emory University's Glenn Auditorium early Monday afternoon and found a place about halfway back in the pews. The building is a restored church and settled in. After digging a notebook and a pen from my bag, I saw that Paul was already sitting quietly in his chair on the stage alone, waiting for things to get started. We hadn't met, but as I knew he knew, I was already working on this book. When I looked up from my notebook and pens, I had just enough time to think, oh look, there's Paul Simon sitting by himself on the stage before his eyes seemed to fix on my face. There was no one else near me, and he was looking really hard in that unblinking stare-you-down way. Or that's how it seemed to me. I had contacted Joseph Skybell to see if I could attend the lectures. He was the professor in charge of the lecture series. And he had been most helpful in clearing my way, and I supposed he might have told Paul I was going to be lurking around the campus. Like most published writers, I'm easy to find on the internet. Maybe he'd taken a glance so he'd be prepared in case I came marching up to confront him. What could I do? I looked back at him and he kept looking back at me. Were we having a staring contest? Was he engaging with me or was he seething at me? Was I imagining the whole thing? I doubt this went on longer than 15 seconds, but as it turns out, that's a lot of time to think when the subject of your new book is giving you the once, twice, and thrice over in a church in Atlanta. He hadn't authorized my book. He had no enthusiasm for biographies, I learned. But since I was enthusiastic enough for the both of us, I got to work anyway. I heard from his co-manager brother, Eddie, a few times and received a phone call from Jeff Kramer, the other co-manager, who made it clear that the prospect of my book was causing some anxiety around certain Brill Building offices, which is where Paul's offices are. I worked closely with other subjects, less closely with others, and was happy to talk about my approach and address their concerns, but they weren't interested in that. He didn't look angry, stern, maybe, impassive, definitely. Eventually, he raised his hand and turned away, not just sort of away, but 45 degrees away. Like, I'm not looking at you anymore. I'm looking at this totally different thing, and so we're done. He did it like this. Oh, just above face level, his palm flat and perpendicular to the floor, like a stereotyped movie Native American going, "How?" Or a traffic cop saying, "Stop!" Or maybe a guy signaling to his uninvited biographer to keep his distance, which is understandable on a human level, but less so in the wake of 50 plus years of public life. All that self-revelation in his music, in the hundreds of thousands of words of interviews he's given, talking about his wives, his lovers, his astonishingly screwed up relationship with the friend slash musical partner he will sometimes insist had no real impact on him at all, and then turn around and say that their lives have always been woven together. And his father, his creative blocks, his anxieties, his therapists, and more. Still, don't look at me, or not, at least, at what I don't want you to see. Don't notice that Paul really was Jerry Landis, just he was also True Taylor and Paul Kane, even if his early folk songs were a little overblown. One Trick Pony's Joan 11 was a mashup of all three, given his own Paul Kane folk song, Soft Parachutes, and Jerry Landis's one-hit track record. Levin also shared Jerry Landis's initials, as per the Jewish tradition of giving a newborn a name with the same initials as a deceased relative. But the film is full of hints about Paul and the undergirding of his most essential self. So, thank you.